wanted to ask you, the senators were invited to attend a dinner in Malacañang, and correct me if I'm wrong, weren't all the senators invited, or is only the was only the new majority invited?
I think all the senators were invited, but the old leadership, of course, under Senator President Zubiri, I included in that as Deputy Majority Leader. We did not go anymore because I think it will feel awkward, no? Because emotions are still high, considering that we were just taken out just Monday, and that was Tuesday evening, and that was really so that's the reason that why we really purposely didn't go anymore.
Well, two of your colleagues in the bloc went, Senator Loren Legarda and Senator Sherwin Gatchalian. What are your thoughts?
It's okay. They asked permission if they can go. Then you said that it's good that they can go, no? Because like me, Karen, personally, I really felt bad. You know, I have to be honest with you, because I think there was no really compelling reason really to replace Senate President Big Zubiri, who really fought for the institution, allowed the senators to do their own thing, to maintain our independence. And I would say that we had a good performance, and that's why, Karen, I have to admit that I really felt bad, because I really loved this job, no? Being Deputy Majority Leader, subbing for the Senate President for Majority Leader, especially during budget seasons. We still until the wee hours in the morning, but you know, I love this job, the fulfillment. But now, that was taken from us, so we will now be just normal senators. And I'm not used, Karen, because probably my orientation being a former mayor, I'm really used to being busy. So that's the reason why I really didn't go also to the palace anymore.
Okay, I wanted to ask you, do you believe there were outside forces? Do you believe Malacañang had a hand or an influence in the change of leadership?
Well, Karen, as I mentioned earlier, there's no reason for Senator Mig Zubiri to be replaced, because there is no scandals, scam, any issue on corruption or whatever. What we have is just yung mga black propaganda coming from the other house. And I think it started January, no, with the People's Initiative issue or charter change. It became the conflict and the friction between the House leaders and the Senate became very hot, so to speak. So it started there, the coup rumors in January. It died down a bit, and then it was resuscitated during the PDEA leaks hearing recently. And I would think it was, no, because that was the last issue before SP Mix was replaced, no? And I think that was the final nail on the coffin, so to speak, on the leadership. Karen, I would say that as I'm a witness on how Mig Zubiri handled the Senate. Everybody was happy. He allowed all the senators their independence. He allowed all the chairmanship to do their own thing. It's their prerogative on how they would steer their committee. So he did dictate or stop them from doing their thing. And all the employee staff all love him. You know, his personality is really very amiable and acceptable. So I think that really caused his demise also, no? By fighting for the Senate's independence. I think that really contributed to his downfall, no, as a Senate president. President, to your question, whether there were external forces behind, I would say so, because as I mentioned, I think all the senators know that they had the free hand in everything. They were satisfied, I would say. And ako, masasabi ko sa kanila, walang naging kasalanan si Mig Zubiri sa inyo bilang Senate President. Lahat ng inyong hiningi, lahat ng inyong request, pinagbigyan, all of you were able to do your own thing with your respective committees. So there was really no compelling reason to replace him. Alam po na ating makasamahan yan. And Saturday, Karen, we were confident that we still had the numbers. But Sunday, the tides changed. And we can just surmise. I don't want to speculate or name anybody, but I would think it will be somebody higher than the Senate, no, to influence the minds and the positions of the senators for them to have a change of heart.
Okay, I wanted to ask you, I interviewed your brother, Senator Jingoy Estrada, yesterday. Sources say that he and Senator Bongrevilla took the lead in actually getting the signatures, getting the support for the ouster. Is that the same information you have?
Well, we receive information, no, about that, but I think they are part of that group. On the other group that seek a change in leadership, Karen. Mm-hmm. Alam mo no, sa Senado, in politics, just like in the Senate, walang forever sa politika. The change in Senate leadership is an evidence of that, and we just have to accept it. But while I'm really, as I mentioned, I'm really sad that my friend and my Senate President, no, may Subiri, lost the Senate presidency, but despite his sterling performance, we take comfort that there was a peaceful change and orderly transfer of leadership to Senator Escudero. And I can just wish him well. I know that he's an experienced, intelligent, bright, and an experienced public servant.
Okay. So, Senator, what happens now? So, Senator Migzubiri joked that, oh, you can call us the Magic Seven, right? But we all know that you are each your own republic, so to speak. But what happens now? What's the plan? Former Senate President Franklin Drilon said, if the seven were to be solid and you join the minority, you would then be nine. And that makes the minority now really a force to reckon with. So are there talks that your bloc would join the minority in the Senate, or it won't go that far? At the end of the day, you'll still belong to the majority.
Karen, first of all, one regret also that we lost the leadership. Our bloc, not the seatmates bloc originally, all the senators know that we are the workhorses of the Senate. No? And not to pat ourselves on the back, Karen, but I would think that the priority measures asked by this administration, I would say 70 to 80% were outputs of this bloc. No, it's either sponsored or authored by our group. And we are the ones from start to finish. I'm the last out in the Senate, no, being the deputy majority leader. And that's a sad thing, no, that we are the workhorse of the Senate. We are the ones who really work hard. Everybody knows that.
Well, and I wanted to ask you, Senator, before we go to that, what happens is sources have told me that one of the disappointing things about the leadership was that LEDAC, the priorities of the president when it comes to LEDAC, it wasn't moving. So if there you know Senate President Cheese Escudero, when he made a speech, that's the first thing he said, we're going to prioritize LEDAC.
Karen, I don't think that is true. That is the accusation and black propaganda of the House, from the House, no? And that started during the heat of the PI conflict. And that is not true. But Karen, you have to understand that the difference between the character of the Senate and I've been to the House as well, no? And it's really parochial. What you can bring to the districts, that is what is your concern. In the Senate, being nationally elected, giving the mandate nationally, we look at the national perspective, and we really, Karen, you know, talagang lahat dyan binubusisi, dadaan ka talaga sa butas ng karam before you are able to pass a measure. No, everything is deliberated on. No, but that's the reality of it. And as I mentioned earlier, all the LEDAC measures, time, but we were able to pass a lot, no? Nahabol po namin, like the PPP code sponsored by yours truly, the automatic income classification, the Procurement Act by Sani Angara, the tax measures by Senator Gatchalian, labor measures by Senator Joel Villanueva, yung mga ease of doing business by Senator Zubiri. Nakahabol po kami, and I that is not true. Na mas matagal po kami, admittedly, but I think we, in terms of priority measures, we were able to pass most of it. Karen, as you to your other query, what happens to us? I would like to answer that. The decision right now, we are still seven. That's still a formidable force, no? That's almost one third of the Senate. And we remained intact. We call ourselves we were called as the Magic Seven or Magnificent Seven. Now we are calling ourselves the Solid Seven. Our decision is to remain independent at this time while emotions are high. We want to think about it during the break. At least we can think better, no? When emotions are, I would simmer down. Right now, the decision is we will remain independent, but we are considering also joining the minority.
I'm sorry. Villanueva. Wait. Joining the minority, what did you say? You are thinking about it?
Yes, that's one of the considerations. No? Because we are not part of the majority anyway. So it's either we remain independent, strongly supporting the administration, or another consideration is Senator Joel, myself, and Senator Nancy are thinking of probably joining the minority. No, because we are used to being the minority. From I think majority of my life as a senator, we were in the minority with Senator Nancy Binay. So Senator Coco Pimentel is talking to us if we want to join.
Okay, but essentially, when you are in the minority, that would mean that you are not supporting the administration's platforms, what the administration is pushing for. I understand how emotional it can get when you change leadership in the Senate, but then this is also about supporting the sitting president.
That is correct, Karen. I think we have proven that time and again that our group has really supported this administration. Even Senate President Mizubiri has remained very loyal to the president. No, that's the sad part about it. No, having that good performance, keeping the Senate's integrity and fighting for the independence, cost us our jobs. But we are not sour grapes, Karen. But we just want to make sure and ensure the Senate's independence. Being in the minority does not mean you are against the administration, no? But we are just on the other side in the Senate leadership. But again, we were fighting for the Senate's independence even during our time under the leadership of Senate President Mizubiri. And we want it that way, no? Because as you mentioned earlier, there are speculations that Malacanang.
But how probably could you be solid if some of you want to join the minority? I mean, can you imagine your other colleagues being in the minority?
No. We are still talking about it, and we will talk about it again. While on break, we will be going on our respective vacation to cool ourselves, cool our heads, so to speak, and emotions. So we will just meet again probably sometime July before the SONA as to what our decision will be. And as I mentioned, I am hoping that we will remain intact because, Karen, you are correct. We are, and Senator Dillon is correct, that we are a formidable force when we remain solid, no? Because we're still seven.
If you remain solid, yeah.
Yeah.
My next question is, what about committee chairmanships? Senate President Cheese Escudero said there are over 45 committees, am I right? In the Senate, 45. So does this mean at this point that you could still be committee chairman?
Yes, because Karen, you know, the Senate were only 24. No, we used to have two or three committees because we have to divide the work among ourselves. Yeah. Otherwise, other committees will not move. So they offered to us they left us with about six committees. No, the new majority already, of course, they are the priority. They got the choice, and the choice committees already definitely would go to them. So we were left with six, and I would say that some of us were not satisfied with some of the committees that were left. I myself, no, I would have wanted another committee, but of course,
what being would you have wanted? I'm curious. What would you have wanted?
I'm a committee on local government now, committee on house, and I resigned from this post so that to give a free hand for the new for the new leadership. Mm-hmm. I've been vice chairman of a committee on public services, and Karen, and you know, that has been my advocacy ever since.
Yeah.
And
But my sources tell me your colleagues are all fighting for public services.
Well,
It's a very
probably
plumb committee.
Because it's public services and franchise. You know me, Karen, I'm advocating railway system, airports, modern transport modernization. I think that really suits me. But it's understandable that it will already go to the new leadership, no? To those who supported the new leadership. So there are other committees, no? Yung siguro, in line with my advocacy, tourism and others. But that has been taken as well. So we'll just see what is left. So that will be part of our decision. If we're not satisfied with the committees that are left, then probably that's when we decide whether we go minority or remain with us independent supporting the administration.
But what happens, for example? I mean, you were deputy majority floor leader. Is that correct? Right?
Yes, yeah. That is correct.
Yeah, right. And then you had Joel Villanueva, majority floor, Lauren Legarda, Senate pro tempore. I mean, that's like the whip. These positions are quite powerful in the Senate.
Yes, correct, Karen. I think we had a very efficient and we had a very good chemistry because we were already blocks, a block already to begin with, no? As a seatmates block when we were not in the leadership then. So when Senate President Zubiri ascended the Senate leadership, then we were always there, no? Our chemistry, everything, we work well together. So we cover for each other. Me, as I mentioned, Karen, ako yung first in, last out dyan sa Senado. I wait for if Senate President Mig Zubiri needs to leave or the majority leader, I have to be on the floor. Okay. And I really love this job, no? But
I'm curious. Yeah. No. I get you. You loved the responsibilities clearly that came. You love the responsibility that came with the job. What happens to Senator Ronald Bato de la Rosa? Has he spoken with Senator Mig Zubiri? I mean, that was quite surprising. Drilon said that he was giving a speech, an emotional speech, thanking those who supported him. And it turned out he didn't know that Senator Bato de la Rosa already signed support for Chief Escudero. And to think, as you said, this was the nail on the coffin. And it was really the fact that in the end, Bato even called the former executive secretary, Jojo Ochoa, right, to the hearing. Was, by the way, a former, is it right to say, a former law partner of First Lady Lisa Araneta Marcos?
Well, Karen, I really feel bad as well. Feel sad also for Senator De La Rosa. And I feel bad for SP Mig Zubiri because we, as I mentioned earlier, we think that was the final nail on the coffin, no? That PDEA leaks hearing. And, you know, Karen, Senator Zubiri has been fighting for and protecting the senators and allowing them, not their prerogative on how they would want to run their committees on issues, on any topics. Bahala kayo. He doesn't stop because that's the independence and character of the Senate. Not only with Sen Bato, with others as well. A number of times I was a witness on how he fought for the independence of the Senate by allowing a senator to do their own thing. So nakakalungkot talaga. I think, as I mentioned, ito na talaga yung this broke camel's back. But I don't know, I would say I feel bad also for Sen Bato. I think he was under immense pressure, no, from external forces for him to change, to have a change of heart. Because I had a talk with him, Karen, no, before, probably an hour before we started session and had a change in leadership, we were talking. Sabi ko sa kanya, Chief, sabi ko, sana wag kang aalis, wag mong iwanan si Senate President Mig Zubiri. Kasi alam pa natin, nagsimula ang lahat ng yan dahil doon sa hearing mo, hindi maganda. So he said he agreed with me. Sabi niya, kahit mag-minority ako, kaya lang, I think he was under immense pressure for him to have a change of heart, Karen. That must be a very powerful people behind, no, this move.
Oh, But do you think it was immense pressure, or he probably thought, I'm running in 2025, you know, I need all the support I can get. I'm just curious. But let's move forward. I have a list here of the new committee chairmanships. And a good question is, how could you join the minority if Miggs was given the CA membership, a CA membership, and the Committee on Economic Affairs? So that doesn't make him, you can't be part of the minority if he was given a chairmanship.
I think that it doesn't stop you, though, from, I think we will still talk about it, though, but I think I was offered also, though, because I used to defend the budget, some major agencies a lot, also to become vice chair, because I am used to it. I defend a lot of, as I mentioned. But if I, Senator Ontiveros is part of the minority, but she is also vice chair, no, of Committee on Finance. She defends certain agencies as well. So,
yes.
It doesn't, it's been, Karen.
Okay. So I want to read the list. Let me know if this is so far the latest that is there. So you have Committee Chairman Miggs Umiri for Economic Affairs and Mark Villar for GOCCs, right? Is that correct? And then Alan Cayetano, Chairman for Trade and Industry, Pia Cayetano for Energy, Grace Poe for Finance Committee, and Higher Tech Voc Ed is still Alan Cayetano. Senator Sunny Angara is moved from finance to now justice and HR, human rights. And then you have Senator Binay for futures thinking and SDGs. Is this correct?
That's correct, Karen.
Okay, and you, J.D. Ejercito, local government, and then Joel Villanueva, labor and employment. What was he before, even before majority? He was like TESDA, I remember.
No, as majority leader, he's an ex-officio member of all the committees.
I see. Okay. And then Rafi Tulfo gets public services. Does this mean you can be a vice chair or not necessarily? Doesn't work that way.
It depends on the chair. So if he or she would like to get me as a vice chair, then that's the prerogative.
Okay. And then Lito Lapid, tourism, and Amy Marcos, housing, urban planning. Did this change? What was Senator Amy Marcos?
That was my old committee as well, the Committee on Housing.
I see. What was Senator Amy before? Foreign Affairs.
Foreign Relations, yes.
Foreign Relations. And was she removed of that?
I think she also, she retained.
She retained.
Most of the majority retained their respective committees. They just got new committees added to them.
Okay. And then, Francis Tolentino is Admiralty Zone and Ethics, correct?
Yes, correct. Okay. And
yeah, so those are the new chairmanships, the list that I have. And I wanted to ask you, is it better for you, for your group, to be independent than minority? In terms of getting things done, being in the game, which is better, being independent or being minority?
As of now, our decision is to remain independent. And, Karen, we are not in case, because in fairness to our minority leader at present, no, Senator Coco Pimentel and Senator Riza, they may be in the minority, but they are not obstructionists. No?
And to be fair, Senator Riza Ontiveros is stellar. She is shining, right? I mean, as a minority, she's really...
They're doing their job. They're doing
exactly,
their
job. Yeah.
Likewise, Senator Coco Pimentel has been... Yeah. Sabi ko, dadaan ka sa butas ng karayom. He has been doing his job as well. He really scrutinizes everything. And I would think that doesn't mean we are obstructionists just in case. So we are just improving. And in fact, when I sponsor a bill, when the minority stands, I appreciate it because it enhances and improves no, the measures, no, but there are things that we do not see. So we have a very good working relationship. As a matter of fact, even our minority leader has praises to Senator President Meek Zubiri for allowing them to play the role.
Okay, so I wanted to ask you, this is something that's happened recently in the House. What are your thoughts about divorce, right? Because the House has already okayed, they've approved the divorce bill on final reading. Where do you stand with this?
Well, that will be a very controversial issue. We have to weigh things, Karen. No, of course, I have to admit that being us of a predominantly Catholic country, being Christians, it has it's a big factor in our decision. But there are a lot of us, Karen, a lot of Filipinos also deserve. I believe in second chances, Karen. No, there are relationships that are really irreconcilable already. Some are even miserable, and nobody deserves to be miserable their whole life. No, everybody deserves to be happy again, Karen. So,
Are you seeing divorce as a possible model? I mean, because what we have in the country is annulment. So what we're saying, your marriage is null and void, right? Which is not the case for many people, frankly, right? So that's the thing. It's we live in this, some have said it's almost hypocritical to make a marriage appear to be null and void when my God, tatlo anak nung unang asawa, magkasama naman sila ng 15 taon. Tapos, alam mo yun, para mag-asawa ka ulit, dapat annulled.
Yeah, that is correct, Karen. And I think if you look at the countries, there are a lot of countries that already have divorce. Again, Karen, I also believe in the family as much as possible. We have to preserve the family, being Christians, no? But if we have to face reality, accept reality that there are couples that are really have irreconcilable relationships or differences, and especially those who are miserable already, everybody deserves to be happy as well. So it will be we still have to weigh things. I'm considering also. As I mentioned, everybody deserves a second chance, and we all deserve to be happy. No, but that has to be. It's a very big issue that has to be weighed carefully, Karen.
Okay. All right. Well, I do hope to have you back on Head Start. We can talk about more issues. I mean, your passion for rails is one thing, but China also, right now there are cyber libel raps against Tony Leachon over that investigation. But we can talk about that also another time. I want to thank you for joining me today, Senator J.V. Ejercito. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Karen.